Macmillan Audio presents Couple Found Slain After a Family Murder by Mikita Brottman. Read for you by Christina Delaine, with an introduction read by the author.
Introduction. Through our many conversations, through his own written recollections, and by providing me with his psychiatric and police records, Brian Bechtold has helped me write this book. I've also relied on other primary documents, court audio and transcripts, police logs, diagrams, photographs, incident reports, and in-person interviews. This is a work of nonfiction. However, some of the dialogue has been recreated based on information from various sources, and some of the names and identifying details have been changed. Most true crime stories focus on the build-up to the crime, the incident itself, and the quest for justice. They're propelled by the need to solve a mystery or find resolution. They end, inevitably, with the arrest and confinement of the perpetrator. The prosaic life, lit up for a moment by the thrill of the crime, returns to obscurity. The curtain comes down. But the end of one story is the beginning of another. Most murders are committed by young men under 30. These men disappear from public view, but they're still here. Their lives go on, in maximum security prisons, in forensic hospitals, and even on death row. They change and grow. They develop new interests, form new friendships, work at different jobs. People no longer recognize their names. Eventually, they become middle-aged or elderly, long-timers going about their daily routines, washing floors, cleaning bathrooms, serving food. Sometimes they even return to live quietly among us. One famous example, Nathan Leopold, of the Leopold and Loeb case, was released from prison at age 54, married a widowed florist, and moved to Puerto Rico, where he wrote a well-received book on the island's bird life. True crime deals with the victims before and after, the community's suffering, the hunt, the cops, the capture, the trial, the verdict. This book is about another part of the story, the part that begins when the verdict is announced, the sentence handed down. Couple Found Slain is a compelling headline. The scene it conjures up is lurid and frightening. It shuts out further thought. It's like a burst of gunfire, explosive and short-lived. The rest of the story, dense and messy, lies beneath.
1. Still Life. Port St. Joe, Florida, Friday, February 21, 1992, 1:30 p.m. Officer Timothy Hightower was finishing up some paperwork at the front desk of police headquarters. It had been a quiet week. The district, whose population was small and mostly rural, had seen its usual share of petty thefts and burglaries, but nothing more serious. Tourists were scarce in February. Scallop season was over. Other than the mosquitoes, the biggest problem was hurricanes, which could move in unpredictably from the Gulf of Mexico to make landfall on Cape San Blas. But it wasn't the season for storms. The front door opened. Hightower looked up and saw a young man walking toward the desk. He was thin, pale, and jittery.
"What can I help you with, sir?"
the officer asked, suddenly feeling uneasy. The young man held his gaze.
"Something bad happened," he said.
Hillendale, Maryland, Friday, February 21st, 3:15 p.m. Jim Drury, a homicide detective in the Montgomery County Police Department, was driving home from work when he picked up a dispatch call on the radio, asking for officers to respond to a residence in Hillendale, a suburb of Washington, D.C., just north of Silver Spring, to check on the welfare of the occupants. Because Drury wasn't far from the address given by the dispatcher, he decided to drop by and see if he could help out. He arrived at around 3:30 p.m. The house on Green Forest Drive was a split-level brick home set back about 200 feet from the road on a slight incline. There were signs of neglect. Two empty trash cans sat out in front of the house. The mailbox was full, and a package sat unclaimed on the front porch. The responding officers told Drury that the house was locked. They'd rung the bell and hammered on the front door, but no one had replied. If the residents were out, Drury reasoned, they couldn't have been gone long, because they'd left the television on. He could hear it playing somewhere inside the house. Yet, according to its postmark, the package on the front porch had arrived almost a week ago, and there was a note on the door from someone named Teresa, expressing her concern about the residents and asking the police to get in touch. Drury went around the back of the house, crossing a small patio, and approached a sliding glass door. Pressing his face against the glass, he could make out what appeared to be a woman sitting in a chair in the living room. Her body was covered by a multicolored quilt. Only her head was visible. It was obvious to Drury that she was dead. He also saw the feet and lower legs of a man lying face down on the kitchen floor. The detective pulled out his radio and called headquarters. They had a double homicide on their hands. The sliding doors at the back were locked, and so were the windows. Not wanting to break the glass, Drury decided to call the fire and rescue team and get them to force the doors open. He also placed a call to John Tauber, the Maryland deputy medical examiner. By the time fire and rescue had arrived, the crime scene technicians were on the scene, along with four more detectives from the homicide/sex division of the Montgomery County Police Department. They entered the house at around 4:40 p.m. The odor was almost unbearable. The rear door led into an open-plan dining room, which was separated from the kitchen area by a stone and wood counter. The chandelier in the dining room was on. So were the overhead lights in the kitchen. A man's body lay on the kitchen floor. He appeared to have been killed while preparing a meal. On the kitchen table was a bowl containing the remains of what looked like breakfast cereal, and on a plate beside the stove were some bits of fish. Fish bones lay on a sheet of aluminum foil. The body was fully clothed, the skin bloated and bluish-green. From the state of decomposition, Drury estimated that the man had been dead for at least 10 days. There was a shotgun wound to the back of his right shoulder, and some blood splatter on the front of the dishwasher to the left of his head. On the floor near the body, the red linoleum was black with dried blood, which made Drury suspect the man may have been moved or rolled over. Both pockets of his pants were empty. Inside, the place was a mess. The trash hadn't been taken out for weeks, and the water had been cut off. Dirty dishes and utensils were stacked on the counter and the kitchen table, along with cans of food, a box of Rice Krispies, a spray can of insect repellent, a box of tea bags, bottles of cooking oil, Gatorade, condiments, and medicine, a bag of oranges, an open container of milk, empty takeaway cartons, and a half-eaten baguette. The woman's body lay on a recliner beside the living room fireplace, in front of the still-playing television. This body, too, was dark and bloated by decomposition. The skin was coming loose, and the flesh swarmed with maggots. A tube sticking out from under the quilt was connected to an oxygen cylinder on the floor. When police uncovered the woman's body, they found two shotgun wounds, one to her right breast and the other to the front of her throat. A gold crucifix around her neck had been damaged by the bullet. Shotgun pellet holes were also found in the back of the recliner. Police found a spent 12-gauge shotgun shell on the couch and another on the living room floor by the entryway to the kitchen. At 5:10 p.m., the medical examiner arrived. Detective Drury told the responding officers to secure the house, then called the police photographer, Joseph Niebauer, to take shots of the scene. He also placed a call to the state attorney's office, informing them of the crime, and another to Bell Funeral Home, asking the mortician to transport the bodies to the office of the chief medical examiner in Baltimore in preparation for autopsy. Like the rest of the house, the living room looked as if it hadn't been cleaned for months. The surfaces were dusty, and the floor was ankle-deep in trash. Newspapers, telephone directories, candy wrappers, empty boxes of Oreos and breakfast cereal, video cassettes, towels, drinking glasses, dirty utensils, medicine and pill bottles, an electric blanket, a heating pad, wadded-up tissues, various items of clothing, a teddy bear, a walker, pillows, blankets, paper towels, two cans of talcum powder, the leg of a plastic doll, a hairbrush, a Bible, an emesis basin, and an oxygen tank. There was also a TV guide open to a page on which the phrase "go to hell" had been smeared, apparently in blood. Walking down the hall to the front of the house, Detective Drury came to a foyer from which a short flight of stairs led down to a basement den. This was just as messy as the living room, only here, all the trash had been pushed to the sides of the room, uncovering a large circle of empty carpet. In the middle of the circle was a black stain, as if something had been spilled or burned there. A blanket had been hung over the window. Near the left wall of the den was a stained couch, an armchair with its stuffing coming out, a table and a dusty stereo system with two large speakers. The piles of trash contained a pair of jeans, candy wrappers, blankets, plastic bags, more empty Oreo boxes, towels, tissues, magazines, athletic clothing, two tennis rackets, a pair of shorts, peanuts, coins, potato chips, packaging, cassette tapes, an ironing board, a briefcase, and 23 empty Coke and Pepsi cans, many of them crushed or flattened. On a side table was the cut-off portion of a shotgun barrel and an empty styrofoam box that had once contained a shotgun. One of the police officers found the primer end of a 12-gauge shotgun shell on the bookcase. Upstairs in the four bedrooms, things were a little more orderly. The first room Drury entered appeared to have been unused. The bed was neatly made and the walls bare, apart from a large wooden crucifix. On the dresser lay a pile of blankets, a letter opener, and a Panama hat. The second bedroom he investigated overlooked the backyard and contained a king-size four-poster bed. This bed, too, was neatly made. A bedside tray contained a jumble of pill bottles, medicines, droppers, and tissues. The room was cluttered with cardboard boxes, an inflatable mattress, laundry hampers, and piles of clothes. The two other bedrooms were even more cluttered. The first contained piles of papers, an unmade queen-size bed, and mounds of sheets, pillows, and dirty laundry. The fourth bedroom was small and narrow. There were four indentations in the door that looked as though they had been made by someone punching the wood with a fist. On the floor around the unmade bed were magazines and piles of dirty laundry. A large television set faced the bed. On top of the television set was a bare lamp with no shade, nine empty Pepsi cans, two half-empty 2-liter soda bottles, a glass serving bowl full of quarters, a dish of dried-up used tea bags, an empty bottle of soy sauce, a hairbrush, a stereo, two electric heaters, a nasal spray, and a pile of wadded-up tissues. On top of a chest of drawers were 14 martial arts trophies. A shelf on the opposite wall held another 12. To the right of the headboard on the floor, police found a spent 12-gauge shotgun shell. Whatever had happened to this family, Drury realized, had taken place some time ago. The detritus had been accumulating for years. At the same time, The house still contained recognizable signs of ordinary domestic life. Framed baby pictures on the living room wall, dried flower arrangements, Catholic prayer cards attached with magnets to the doors of the fridge. The garage contained a lawnmower, garden tools, and bags of mulch. The valance and tiered curtains in the living room window looked homemade. On a side table in the foyer, clay pots held peace lilies, maidenhair ferns, and fiddles.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.